So good afternoon everyone. So last class we have seen how to find a maxima or minima in two variable. So for that the first derivative test we have to put first partial derivative with respect to x and y 0. You will get the point where maxima or minima can occur, and based on these three criteria you can conclude that it is either maxima or minima or saddle point. And we have seen one example, this one. And these are the points we got, so that we have already seen in the last class. So today we'll do this one. So the question is, here we have to find absolute maximum and minimum of this function, and region is also given. So first I will draw this region. In that region we have to find the absolute maxima and minimum. So here x equal to 0 is given, that means it is y-axis, y equal to 0 is the x-axis, so I am just drawing the picture. So this line is y equal to 0, this one is x equal to 0, so if this is x-axis and this is y-axis, and this one y equal to 9 minus x will give the straight line passing through point 9 comma 0 and 0 comma 9. So this one is the x plus y equal to 9. So in this region we have to find where is this function has maxima or minima, and out of all we have to find the absolute maxima, that means global maxima and global minima. So in two variable, if you want to find maxima and minima, the first step is you have to find the first partial derivative of this function with respect to x. So what will be the first partial derivative of this function with respect to x and y? So this is point O, this is point A, and this is point B.
2 minus 2x.
Yes, 2 minus 2x.
2 minus 2y.
2 minus 2y. So in order to get the point where maxima or minima can occur, we have to put this is 0. That means this equal to 0 implies some x, this equal to 0 implies some x. So we'll get a point. So what is the point? After solving these two equations, you will get the value of x equal to 1 and value of y equal to also 1. So on solving this fx and fy both are equal to 0, this will imply that we'll get a point x naught comma y naught. So at this point maxima or minima can occur. So how to check that this point is maximum or minimum or saddle point? We have to go to the higher order test. That means we have to find the double derivative of this function fxx, x, y and y, x both are same in this case because this function is anyway. So what is these three value?
-2, -2, 0.
This one we will give with respect to x -2.
0, -2.
This is 0 and this is -2. So here in this case, this fxx, that is, there is no xy function. If suppose some xy function is there, we will replace by 1, 1. So the value of r is... -2 and t is -2. Then rt minus s square will calculate and we'll see it is positive, negative or 0.
Yeah,
so r means the value of this f of xx at point 1 comma 1, because there is no xy, that's why r is also -2 here, because these are constant number. If some function of xy is there, then we'll replace this 1 comma 1, the point we got this point, in order to get the value of r, s and t. So now Now rt minus s square, r is minus 2, t is also minus 2, s is 0, so it will give 4. So rt minus s square is positive, but r is negative. So this point 1 comma 1, so this is at point 1 comma 1. So this implies that 1 comma 1 will be, maxima or minima?
Maxima.
Yeah,
maxima.
Local. So, but his question, it is asked that what is absolute maximum and minimum? That means you have to find the global maxima or global minima. So, can anyone tell what will be the global maxima or global minima? So we got only one single point, 1 comma 1. Question is what, find the global maxima or global minima, or absolute maxima or absolute minima. So can we say 1 comma 1 is the absolute maxima? Yes or no?
No.
So how to find absolute maxima and absolute minima?
Checking the border point.
Boundary points.
Yes sir, boundary conditions.
Yes, because whatever method we apply, it will give only information about interior point. It may give a boundary point, but it is not giving any boundary point in this case. So we have to check boundary separately. It may happen that maxima or minima occur at this boundary. So boundary is this one. 0 to A, A to B, and this O to B, origin to B. So we have to check separately all three boundary. It may happen that maxima or minima can occur at boundary, because in this procedure you will never get any information about boundary. So now we'll check one by one all three boundary. So first I will check this boundary OA. So that is along x-axis, whatever boundary is here. So I will making here case one, all three boundary I will do along the boundary OA. So what is this OA? That means for this y equal to 0, and what is the value of x along this boundary? X will start from 0, it will go up to along this boundary, in mathematical term y equal to 0, and x is from, it will start from 0, it will go up to
9.
So boundary means y equal to 0 and x from 0 to 9. So this is the boundary actually we are considering in the case 1. So now along this boundary, what will be the function and what will be the maxima minima of the same function? So when y equal to 0, the function will become, if you put y equal to 0, whatever will left, that will be the function along this boundary. So now f, so along this boundary I am putting y equal to 0, because y equal to 0 along this boundary in the function. So if you put y equal to 0, you will get only x term, 2 plus 2x minus x square. 2 plus 2x minus x square, where x lies between 0 to 9. So now we got a new function, 2 plus 2x minus x square, and this is single variable, like only single variable. So we can differentiate with respect to x, we can find the double derivative, we can find where is the maximum or minima for this. So I'm just calling it is some g of x. And now you can do the maximum minima for this. We can differentiate g dash x equal to 0 for point. So g dash x will come 2 minus 2x. Yes?
Minima.
So x will give here 1. This is equal to 0 implies x equal to 1. What is the point we got here? In this case, we got a point x equal to 1 and y equal to 0. Is it okay to everyone? At this point, I am not saying maxima or minima, but at this point something will occur, maxima or minima or anything, but this is the point we got from here, 1, 0. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now again the same problem, once you will consider this function, you are not considering this boundary point 0 and 9. That is missed. The same problem, this domain is closed interval 0 to 9. That means this x equal to 0 is missed and x equal to 9 is also missed. So we'll consider separately. So that's why I'm considering x equal to 0 also, x equal to 9 also, and y is anyway 0 in this case. So these are the three points we will get where maxima or minima can occur. So 1, 0 came from 0 as x equal to 0, but this 0, 0, y is 0, so y will remain 0, but 0 and 9, this boundary point of x, that also we have to consider in this case, because at those boundary point also maxima or minima can occur. So that's why I am considering these two extra point. This 9, 0, and this 0, 0. This one is boundary point, so that's why I'm considering. So these are the three points we got where maxima or minima can occur. Out of these three, which one is the global, we will check later. So here I'm not doing the double derivative because we need only absolute maxima or minima. So whatever points I am getting, I am writing all those points. Once all points will come, then we'll check the functional value over all those points, which one has the maximum value, that is the global maxima, which one has the minimum value, that will be the global minima. So the case one is done, we got 3 points. Now we'll do case two. So one boundary we took, boundary OA. Now which boundary you want to take? Tell me, I will take that boundary.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes. Yes, tell what you want to say.
Sir, how you have found fx and y, fi?
Yeah, you partially differentiate with respect to x, treating y as a constant.
Yes,
even,
sir.
Even if you apply the definition of the limit definition, you will also get the same thing.
Okay, sir.
So now I will consider another case from along OB, then I will consider AB because I have to consider all three cases. So now I am finding maxima or minima along the boundary OB. Along the boundary OB means x equal to 0 and value of y lies from 0 to 9. This boundary, this is 0, this is 9. X equal to 0, y from 0 to 9. So now I will put x equal to 0 in the original differential equation, original function here. If you put here 0, you will get 2 plus 2y minus y square. So in this case, the function will become x value is 0 and y as it is. So we'll get 2 plus 2y minus y square. So now again we will differentiate this function and we'll get the value of y where maxima or minima can occur. That means the derivative of this, again I'm calling it is something h of y. Then for this function h dash y will give 2 minus 2y which is 0. This implies that y equal to 1. So in this case we'll get point x is 0, this 0, y we got 1, so we got 1 point. So what are the other points, that boundary points? Because we will miss in this boundary, so we'll again consider the boundary point. So what are the boundary point?
0, 9.
0, 0, 0.
And x equal to 0 and y equal to 9. So these are 3 points we got. So definitely 0, 0 is repeating in this case, so no problem. Now we'll consider the case number 3. Case 3 means along the boundary AB. So along this case, this one, this AB means what is the value of x and what is the value of y. That means AB means x plus y equal to 9. This x plus y equal to 9. X is from where to where and y from where to where over this line.
Zero to nine.
Both yeah, x is from zero to nine. Y
both
is also from
zero to nine.
Yeah, both from zero to nine. And x plus y sum should be nine. So this function now I will do this 2 plus 2x plus 2y in this original function will replace that one so that again it will come the same thing. That means x plus y equal to 9 and 0 to 9. So now either we can replace x or we can replace y. So which value you want to replace, y equal to 9 minus x or x equal to 9 minus y?
Y equals
9. Y equal to 9.
Okay, so in the original function I will replace y equal to 9 minus x. So from here we will get y equal to 9 minus x. So this y I will replace in the original function. So we will get 2 plus 2x, then 2y means 9 minus x, minus x square, minus y square means 9 minus x whole square. So this is again function of x. We can call some g1 of x and then we can differentiate, we'll get the point. So differentiate this and tell me the point where the value of x, where maxima or minima can occur.
At 5, 4.
5, 4.
9/2, 9/2.
Yes, 9/2, 9/2. So how many points you are getting? One or two? Only one.
Only
so
one.
Yes. So if you put this t dash 0, you will get x equal to 9/2. So once you will put x here, x plus y equal to 9. So on this boundary, you will get point 9/2, 9/2. So in this case we are getting a point 9/2. This is the midpoint and the boundary point. When x equal to 0 you will get y equal to 9, and when x equal to 9 you will get y equal to, so the two boundary point 9, 0 and 0, 9. So these are the points we got. Now we'll check which one is the global maxima and which one is the global minima. So we started, we got with this method, we got only one point, 1, 1, and that is local maxima, but it is global, we don't know. So we considered all three boundaries, 0 to A, 0 to B and then AB. And by considering one boundary, this function of two variable will convert into the single variable. For that also we found maxima or minima by differentiating, and this two extra boundary point also we included. So total how many points we got? 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0. Here also this 0, 0 is repeating, 0, 1, 0, 9, and these three more points. So now we'll check one by one what will be the value of this. So this one up to this we got 1, 1, 3 point here, 3 point here, 3 point here. Out of this three, I mean this 0, 0 is repeating. So total how many points we got?
9 points.
So now what we'll do for global maxima or global minima, we'll check the functional value over all those points, like f1, 1 is what, f9, 0 is what. Which one will give maximum, that will be the global maxima or absolute maxima, and which one will give minimum, that will be the global minima. So if you check the value, like f1, 1, 1 will come 4. So here I calculated all the value. So out of this, now tell me what are the points which have the absolute maxima or absolute minima by looking this value. So out of this, which one is the maximum value?
1, 1.
So 1, 1 is the absolute maxima or global maxima. What is the minimum value?
9 comma 0 0 comma 9
so we 0, got 2.9 comma 0 and 0 comma 9 both it is both point it is absolute minima so this is the final answer 1 comma 1 0 is a absolute maxima and 9 comma 0 and 0 comma 9 is the absolute minimum so this is the final answer so maximum value and minimum value will occur at 9 comma 0 and 0 comma 9 in this domain so this type of things only you will do when you have some bounded domain that some boundary should be there then only you will do like this if boundary is not there like in the previous example here there is a no boundary like function from r2 to r and domain is not bounded so whatever point you will get by this only those point you will check and which one is the maxima like absolute maxima that will be the absolute maxima and which one is the minimum that will be the absolute minima this is the end of maxima minima I will not do more problem sir. You can do practice whatever problem from the book you want yes
sir I did not get that intersection of the points in the previous example that is root 2 comma 0 and
how this point came
yeah yes sir
okay so it is written you have to solve fx equal to 0 and fy equal to 0 can this exponential function will be 0 the answer is no this exponential function can never be 0 right this is not equal to 0 so this cannot be 0 so definitely whatever written in this bracket that must be 0
yes,
so x is common here so if you take the x common from the first one what you will get If you will take x common, you will get 2 minus x square minus y square. That will become plus y square because of this minus sign. This is equal to 0. Is it okay? The first one.
Sir.
From the second one, again y is common. Then you will get 2 minus x square plus y square. So this product is 0. That means either x is 0 or both cases possible x can also be 0 and this in the bracket 2 minus x square plus y square is also 0 so how this 0 comma 0 came that is clear
okay sir. Yes sir
and if you put x equal to 0 here like suppose this is non zero x is 0 then if you put x equal to 0 then you will get y equal to plus minus root 2
yes,
similarly if y equal to 0 you will put then x you will get plus minus root 2 And once you will get the point, you have to find this fxx, fxy, and here it is coming function of xy. Then r will be the value of this at point 0 comma 0. If you want to check 0 comma 0, so you will calculate rst over those points. So this will come rst, and then rt minus s square is negative. Then it is saddle point. If it is positive, then you will check the sine of r. So far now, what we have seen. The multivariable like first we have seen single variable then we came to multivariable and here also we defined limit sequence continuity differentiability now maxima minima so now what will be the next topic
integration
yeah next topic will be the integration so like first we have seen f r to r Now here what we are doing only R2 to R. Like this is multivariables, more than one variable. So R3 is also you can do, but Rn we are not doing. So now the next topic is the integration in several variable. Like if function is from R2 to R or R3 to R. So here these are all real valued function. That means right hand side is R only. It is not a vector valued one. So whatever here we are seeing this right hand side if it is r but this is single variable because only one variable a single variable calculus we have seen already and this function is called real valued so whatever another name is more popular that is called real analysis like here we have seen multivariable so it is also called multivariable or several variable also single variable calculus multivariable calculus after that we will see first we will complete this integration then this topic will complete then we'll go to the vector valued function, not only real valued. That means this r is not r, some vector. And then we'll see the vector calculus. And once we'll finish the vector calculus up to integration, then this syllabus of this course will be finished. So this course is designed for calculus, three type of calculus. One is only for single variable, real valued function. Then multivariable, currently we are reaching only the integration left, and then we'll go to the vector, and then vector calculus will come. So now the next topic is integration. Integration in the two variable. So let me just open this one first. So is it visible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So like we have seen Riemann integration in single variable, something similar to that we will define upper Riemann sum, lower Riemann sum in multivariable. So first we'll see double integral, that means we'll see what is double integral, then we'll see triple integral. If you are integrating n times, then it will become nth integral. So suppose one function is given, and it is given on this rectangle. The domain is given as a rectangle, x from a to b. So here it is a printing mistake, I wrote wrongly. So this should be y. Okay, I will correct it later. So if you draw this picture, so we are defining the integration on this rectangle. Later we'll see how to define integration in some so this line. This is x equal to b line. This a and b can be negative also. And this one is y equal to c, and this one is y equal to d. So this is the domain. So this rectangle can also be denoted by this, like either you will write this x from a to b and y from c to d, or you can write like this, this closed interval ab, this is the cross symbol, it is called the Cartesian product, and cd. So both notation have the same meaning. It is, this means this is the rectangle, whatever I draw the picture. So now let us assume this function is bounded on this, and then we will find the integration of this function. Some function is given over this rectangle. So first we'll see how to do integration on rectangle, then we'll see the how to do integration on some general, that means that shape may not be rectangle. So like in real we did Riemann integration, so what will be the first step? We have to do the partition of the domain, right? The same thing we'll do, this partition of the rectangle. So how to do the partition in the rectangle? We will do the partition of this domain A to B, and we'll do the partition of C to D. It will automatically do the partition of the rectangle. Suppose this is the partition of the domain AB, x0 to xm. And this is partition of the domain Y, Y0 to Yn. It may not be like, suppose this A to B, the length may not be equal to C to D. So even if you take the equal partition length, there are number of points may differ. So here I am taking m number of points in the AB, and here you are taking C and like C to D n number of points. So total how many sub rectangle will come if you divide the domain like this? The original domain is from AB to CD.
Mn
to n.
Yes. So if this is A and this is B. So this is height is C and this is D. So definitely if you divide X into some M equal part, and similarly here N, even not equal doesn't matter. So you will, the original domain is divided into some sub-rectangle. Then like there we are getting interval, then we will find the maximum value, like supremum over that interval, and then divided by length of the interval. But here what we will do, here in each sub-rectangle, we'll find the supremum, we will find infimum, and then this area of this rectangle. That will give the upper Riemann sum and lower Riemann sum. So like suppose this is the ith point, this is xi, then this is xi plus 1. Somewhere here suppose yi or yj, that this, what is the area of this one? if this is xi, this is xi plus 1, similarly this is yj and this is yj plus 1, then what will be the area of this?
Sir, 1 by n into 1
xi
by
plus 1 minus.
Yes, xi plus xi 1 plus minus xi 1 will give this length.
Minus
xi yj plus 1 minus j will give this length, and then you will get area. Okay, so suppose I am calling this length is delta xi, that is the difference between xi plus 1 and this is delta something yj, then this is the area, and then each sub part will find the maximum and minimum, that means supremum and minimum. And because this is bounded domain, for continuous function, the supremum and minimum will exist. So in this case, we'll assume the same thing like we did in the Riemann. So total Mn sub-rectangle. So we'll define the upper Riemann sum and lower Riemann sum. Upper Riemann sum, that I comma jth, that delta xi in delta yj, that is the area, and this is the maximum value. In the single variable, we are doing only the length of that interval. Here we are getting the area of the rectangle and then the maximum value. Like that, if you add all those rectangle, whatever you will get, that is upper sum. If you take the infimum, then you will get the lower sum. So where this capital and capital M and small m are the infimum and the supremum of this xi minus 1 to xi, here yj minus 1 to yj. In this sub rectangle, whatever the minimum value will get, that is small mij. And whatever the maximum value is there, that is capital Mij. So this is upper Riemann sum and this is lower Riemann sum. So similarly, we'll define upper integral and lower integral. That is the infimum of this, that is the supremum of this. If both are equal, then we'll say the function is Riemann integrable, like we did in the single variable. So if both are equal, upper integral and lower integral, then it will say it is Riemann integrable, and it is denoted by this integration symbol over rectangle R. We can write f x y dA. So dA can be dx dy, and some people can write like this. It is exactly something similar to that. So even you will not get this definition, doesn't matter. No question will come based on this definition. Okay, but how we'll define, that's why I explain this one. So here I wrote dA. What is this dA means? That can be dx dy, and this can be dy dx. We don't know what is dx and dy. Like there only we are integrating with respect to x. So here two variable. So it can be either dx dy or dy dx. So I am not writing for the timing, it is dx dy or dy dx. Okay, so that's why here it is written dx comma y. That means we don't know, it is with respect to x you will integrate first, or with respect to y you will integrate first. That for the timing we don't know. So that's why this notation dx comma y, that means integration with respect to x and y, but in which order we don't know. Or that this you can, this both you can write as a dA. That means the area of the dx and dy. Either you will multiply dx dy, then also you will get the same dA, or if you multiply dy dx, then also you will get the same dA. So this definition, why I am saying this definition not that much important, because what we'll do, we'll do the convert the integration into the single variable, and we'll apply whatever knowledge you have about single variable. Like first, like if we support dx dy, then we'll first we'll integrate with respect to x, then we will integrate with respect to y, and then we will get answer. We'll see how we'll get. So no question will come in the exam from this definition anywhere. But there are some result, by using those result you can clearly check, even no need to check. If you this, like suppose some function is continuous on this rectangle, then definitely it is integrable. That means the upper sum and lower sum, this lower integral will be equal. These are some result you can directly use. If it is monotonic function in two variable, like in x direction also it is monotonic, that means you fix y and check in x direction it is monotonic or not. That means treating y as a constant, it is monotonic. Then treating x as a constant, it is monotonic. If in both directions it is monotone, then we'll say that it is integrable. And the third one is, if it is bounded but it has a some finite number of discontinuity, then also it is integrable. So by using this result we can say some function is integrable or not. We'll not go to the actual definition of upper sum and lower sum. Now we'll come to how to find the integration. So let us do this example. The question is, find the integration of this function over this rectangle 0 to 3, x value and y value is 0 to 2. So can you calculate the integration and tell me the answer? That means the question is, find the double integration of over this rectangle R of this function f of x comma y. y d a. So if you do like this, so function value is 4x minus y square. So suppose I am writing dx dy, that means integration of this with respect to x will do first, and then with respect to y. So I am applying the limit of x. This is 0 to 3. So first we will do with respect to x, whatever will come, then we'll integrate with respect to y. But someone can do first with respect to y and then with respect to x. So who is correct? Like, who will do the with respect to x first and then with respect to y, or with respect to y first and then with respect to x? So out of these two integration, which one is equal to this value? We want to find the like, if someone will reverse the order, first integrate with respect to y, then limit of y is 0 to 2, and then integrate with respect to x, limit of x is 0 to 3. So it will give something, it will give something. So which one is the value of this integration? Can anyone guess? Like, which one is correct? Integrating with respect to x first, or with respect to y, or the reverse order? Yes, can anyone tell?
No.
Okay, so let us do with respect to x first or with respect to y first and see what is the answer. So this is the integration. We are integrating with respect to y first, so 0 to 2 here. So if you integrate y with respect to y, so this 4x is a constant. So if you integrate with respect to y, then it will come 4xy. Then integration of y square will come y cube by 3. So whatever you know integration in the single variable, all we can apply here. And then apply the limit 0 to 2. So if you apply the limit 0 to 2, you will get here 8x. Minus 8 by 3. If you apply 0, give 0, this will also give 0, so you will get this much. And now if you integrate with respect to x and apply the limit, the answer will come 28. This is the answer when we integrated with respect to y first and then with respect to x. Like we have seen in the limit, if you apply limit x tending to 0 first and y tending to 0, they may not be equal and they may not give the correct answer. So now we'll reverse the direction and we'll do the same thing. So if you do the reverse, first you will integrate with respect to x, you will get this one. Apply the limit of x 0 to 3 dy, and then with respect to y, you will get the 28 answer. So now what is your conclusion? By looking this example, so from this example it is clear that the answer will come 28. Yes or no? Even whatever order you will integrate, doesn't matter.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Continuous function.
Yeah, function is continuous, someone is saying. So that's why we are getting the answer 28. That is not actual correct reason. So here in this example, we are getting answer 28. So this question is done. Like, we are integrating with respect to x first, or with respect to y, or with respect to y first, with respect to x. So any order you will do here in this case, doesn't matter. You will get the same answer. So I will give one theorem also, under what condition that interchange or change of order will give the same answer. Under what condition? Some condition there, because this is not always true. For this example it will true, but for some other example it may not true. So this is the example. If you do like this integration, this is the domain 0 to 1 x value, and y is value from 0 to x. So in this domain, if you integrate this, what you will get? You will not get same. Like, if you apply first with respect to y, y limit is from 0 to x, then I 0 to x, and after that integrate with respect to x, you will get answer 1. But if you do the reverse direction, first you will integrate with respect to y and then apply integration with respect to, then you will get this answer 5x minus x square by 2. It is depending on x. Here it is answer 1. So which one is the correct answer now in this case? So Just guess what will be the correct answer. 1 or 5x by 2 minus x square.
Second one
means 5x by 2 minus x square by 2. That is the correct answer.
Yes, sir.
No, the first one is the correct answer. So we'll see how. That we'll see later. So from these two examples, it is very much clear that whenever we want to change the order of integration, we cannot change. Like integrating with respect to x or with respect to y will not always work. Like any order will not work always. For first example, it is working and we are getting answer 28. So we'll see under what condition it will work. That is the first question we will deal. This change of order. And the second one is that can we change, if we can change, like if we change somehow, like if there is some rule, like either you will integrate with respect to y and x, or we will integrate with respect to x and y, like any order, if you integrate, you will get the same answer. So how we can manage that also? So there are two type of question. First is when these are equal, then that will be the integration. If they are not equal, can we make equal by modifying something, or modifying function, or modifying limit, or something we can do so that we will able to get the same answer. So the answer of first one is in two part, that is called Phubney's theorem. Phubney's theorem says that if you have rectangle, this A to B and C to D, then if you do the integration, that means the order of change of order of integration is allowed in the rectangle. Like if your domain is the rectangle, you can change the order. Like if you integrate with respect to x or with respect to y, doesn't matter, always you will get the same answer. This is holds in terms of rectangle only. So that means this A and B are some real number, and this ABD cross CD is a rectangle. So if you have domain rectangle, then no need to worry anything. Whatever order you will fill, integrate, you will get the correct answer. So that is nothing but called Phubney's theorem. So if x belongs to AB, is a Riemann integrable function. So like this C to D exists, that means with respect to y, then you will integrate with respect to x. Whatever you will get, that is nothing but the equal to y. The reverse one is first integrate with respect to x and then with respect to y, you will get the same answer. That is also equal to y in case of if domain is rectangle. So here domain is playing more important role. If it is rectangle, then this theorem holds. And in this case, all value will come same. Like if both the hypothesis will hold, then this one, and this integration all are same. So what is the meaning of here both the hypothesis same? That suppose this integration doesn't exist, then we cannot say that this all three are equal, because this is not exist, but this is exist. It may happen that with respect to x, integration is exist, but with respect to y, it is not exist. So this property will hold if integration is exist. Like both integrations should exist, then all are equal. That means the summary of this Phubney's theorem is that you can change order whatever you want. Like you can, if it is two variable, you can first put x, then y. If it is three variable, x, y, z, you can integrate. If you feel integrate with respect to y, integrate first with respect to y, then x, then z. Any order if you integrate, you will always get the same answer. So I hope it is clear. So that's why in example 1, we are getting the same answer, because your domain is rectangle 0 to 3 and 0 to 2. So in that case, whatever order, so if like question is, this question will come, find the integration, then you will not do like both the thing. You can do any one. Any one means which one you will feel easy, you can do. If you do like this 28, and then you can say that by Phubney's theorem, the value of that integration will be 28. That's all. So out of these two, this you can apply, I mean you can use any one method, not like both you have to do if it is rectangle. But if you see in this example 0 to 1, and here y is from 0 to x. So if you draw this picture, it is not a rectangle. So I will just draw the picture. So x equal to 0 is this one, and this is x equal to 1. Here y equal to 0 is this one, and y equal to x is this line. So this is the region. This is not a rectangle. So that's why this is not holds in this case. So it is, the first result is that if it is a rectangle, then we can change the order of integration. That means we can do either with respect to x first or with respect to y. If it is not this one, if it is not rectangle, then what we will do, we will see.
Sir, if we change that y equal to some k,
where
that y equal to k, x is there, sir, then if we choose that y equal to k, then is it possible to get the same value?
Why, what is k?
K, any natural number.
Yeah, if you get any natural number, it will become rectangle. Then you are changing whole domain.
Sir.
That means you are changing the question. That will come later. First, for the timing, if it is rectangle, you can do. If it is not rectangle, what you can do, we will see. So far we have defined the integration on rectangle. We have seen one Phobnis theorem that is worked over the rectangular region. That means the change of order of integration is allowed over rectangular region. That is the summary of Phobnis theorem. Some special case of this Phobnis theorem is there. If fxy is a function of x and y, that means the x and y term you can put separately, and then you can multiply. This is separately means you can write a multiple of x and y, some two different function, then the integration of this is same as integrate with respect to x of this only a x function and with respect to y. Even if you don't know this, you can apply Phobnis theorem. Whatever integration you will get, same thing. Now we'll define the integration over general region. Like if region is not rectangular, like this example we have seen, region is not rectangle, then what we will do? Like the second example, in this case region is coming something like triangle or something else can be region. So for general region, the region other than rectangle, what we can do? So that is also very simple. If you have a region like this, suppose this D is the region, in that region you want to integrate. So it is not a rectangle. So what we will do, we will take a rectangle which will contain this domain. So suppose R is a rectangle, in this picture you can see, which will, this domain D is completely inside that rectangle. And we know how to do integration in rectangle. So even region is not rectangle, we can do by using rectangle. So for that, what we need a rectangle which will contain that domain. So in this domain function is defined, but outside the domain we will assume the value is zero. So outside of this domain D, so if xy belongs to the domain, then this g function is same as f, but if it is outside this region, then its value is zero. So if you integrate g over this rectangle R, it is same as you are integrating function f over the domain D. Because of zero, it will not give any integral part, like it will not contribute any value or any number in the value of the integration. So if it is not rectangular, then also we can do by rectangle to consider a domain such that domain will consider rectangle such that the complete domain will lie inside the rectangle, and then once we'll get this new domain, then we will integrate the modified function, not the original function. What is the modified function? It will take the value f same as in that domain, but zero outside the domain. That means whatever r minus t. So anywhere we will not use this upper Riemann sum, lower Riemann sum definition. So now we'll see the what is the Phobnis theorem for the general, like this type of domain, if the domain is general. So now we'll see the Phobnis theorem for the general region. Suppose D is the domain, that is subset of R2, and function is continuous on that domain. Then what is Phobnis theorem says that if x from A to B and y from f1x to f2x, it may be some function of x. If it is number, then it will become rectangle. And where f1, f2 both are continuous function, then the value of this integration. So here, what this Phobnis theorem, that is a stronger version of the original one. Original one is having f1x as a constant number. That means the function f1 is a constant function, f2 is a constant function. So this is more stronger than the previous Phobnis theorem. So here what it is saying, that if y is a function of x Lagrange lies between f1 and f2, then you have to integrate with respect to y first. Means for you, there is no choice. You have to integrate first with respect to y, then with respect to x, and whatever you will get, that will be the value of this integration. Similarly, another version is that if suppose x lies between g1y to g2y, then you have to integrate first x with respect to x, then you can apply the limit of y from c to d. So these are two different cases. Here we are not changing the order. Based on the limit, we are deciding which one will be the integration. Like we have to integrate first with respect to x or with respect to y. So now go back to the previous example too. So now which one is the answer? Because here y is a function of x f1 to f2. So we have to integrate with respect to y first so that x will come in the answer, and then we will apply the limit of x. By Phoebe's theorem, this one is the correct answer of example 2. So the second, this 5x by 2 minus x square is not the correct answer. So is it clear to everyone?
So can you repeat once again?
Yeah, sorry. So first, in this setup, what you have to see, which one is the constant limit, like a to b, that you have to apply in the last. Which one is the function that you have to apply first. Like y is a function of x, and then you will apply the limit of y in terms of x, you will get completely function of x. Once you will get all in terms of x, then you will integrate with respect to x and then apply limit of x. So y from f1 to f2, then you have to apply first limit of y. Then this integration is nothing but integration with respect to y first, then x. Because if you integrate with respect to y, so some y term will be there. Once you will apply limit, that all terms of y will be replaced by x. So this whole integration will come some function of x. Once it will come function of x, then you can integrate like normal function of x, and then you can apply the limit and you will get the answer.
It would be better if you would explain this with an example, sir.
Yeah, the example will come. So if suppose this x domain from y, so what we'll do, we'll first integrate with respect to x, and then we'll put the limit of this x, that is the function of y. So all things will come in terms of y, and then we will integrate with respect to y, we'll get the answer. So now in this question, the question is the function fxy equal to x plus y, you have to integrate in this domain. So now tell me which you will apply first and which will apply later, with respect to x or with respect to y? With respect to y. Because once you will apply with respect to y, y first and then x from 0 to half. So this is the integration 0 to x square, because y value is from 0 to, so we'll integrate this with respect to y. After that, we'll put the limit of y, whatever you will get, then apply 0 to half, you will get the answer. So if you integrate this, you will get the integration of x with respect to y is xy, integration of y with respect to y is y square by 2, apply limit 0 to x square, you will get complete function of x, and then apply the limit of x. So by Phoebe's theorem, 3 by 160 is the answer. Here you are not allowed to change the order of integration. But in case of rectangle, you are allowed to change the order of integration. You can change the order there. So this example 2 we'll see in the next. And then the next topic is how to change the order of integration. If we want to change, then how to change. So those things we will see in the next class.